We're here to worship the one that is alive forevermore this morning. And we're here to praise and worship him. And I'm going to go ahead and ask you to stand up. We're going to sing here in a second. What are we singing, brother?
401.
401 in the Red Book. And let's just praise and worship our awesome God this morning.
Oh,
We're so blessed just to be in your presence and have your presence among us and with us, not just here in this place, but in all times. And Father, I just pray that you get us out of the way to this morning. Let the Holy Spirit have his way. Let him speak to our hearts, open our minds, and open our ears so we can hear wonderful things from your word. We love you, and we thank you. In your son's precious and holy name that we pray. Amen. As Karen continues to play, let's welcome one another this morning. Psalm 145, verses 17 and 18, he says, "The Lord is righteous in all his ways and is kind in all his works." Listen to verse 18. "The Lord is near to all who call upon him." To all who call upon him in truth. I'm going to ask you a quick question. Has there ever been a time when whatever you're going through, whatever situation, whatever hard time, whatever fire, valley, whatever storm you're going through, has there ever been a time that God has not been there for you? You see, when we come humbly, when we come honestly, and when we come needy to our God, there's never a time that He will turn you away. He's always there. And so I want to encourage you during this time of prayer right here, this altar is going to be open. I just encourage you, whatever it is, bring it. Bring it to the altar. Bring it to Jesus. Come needy. Come humbly. And come honest. And lay it before the God of the universe. And here's the promise that He gives us. He says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God." And here's the promise. "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will be with you." Come needy. Come humbly. Come honest. Bring it here this morning, and He will give you peace. Do you need peace this morning? Altar is open. I ask you to come. Each and every step of the way. We need you every second. And Father, we just lay our burdens. We lay our valleys, our fires. We lay it all before you this morning. And Father, we ask for your guidance. We ask for your wisdom and your strength in every situation. Father, we just ask that your peace and your comfort be upon us. Just shower us with that mercy and grace. And Father, lead and guide us every step of the way into your will so that you can be glorified. Father, I pray for those out there today that are hurting. I pray for those that do not know Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for the church today around the world that we will be your witnesses to a dark and dying world. Father, I pray for our missionaries. I pray for those that are homebound. I pray for those that are in the hospital. Father, I pray for every situation. I don't know what every person's going through this morning, but you do. And Father, I pray that you do what you did for me. Meet them in their greatest need. And just show them your love and your compassion for them. And show them how awesome and wonderful and majestic God that you are. Lead and guide them and give them exactly what they need at this moment. And Father, use us as we go out to boldly and lovingly speak your name and your glory. And Father, we just pray that in all things, that your will be done so that your name can be magnified. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Remain standing while we sing, brother.
Hello, everyone. Tell me the story of Jesus in red book.
Thank you. here.
They see him here.
And they see him here. We know it because he said it.
Jesus said, the world will see him when the world sees us.
That's why together we do this.
We give so that those who've not yet seen can see.
It means something when the world sees how we give.
It means something because we do not look the same.
It means something because we do not sound the same.
It means something because when we give, this is what the world sees.
They see the gospel doing what the world cannot.
They see the gospel making us one. And so we give.
We give so that the missionaries can go.
We give so that churches can be started, hurts can be healed, and truth can be shared.
We give so the world might see Jesus in us, united as one.
First off, before I introduce them to you real quick, I want to go ahead and say this. My mom, sitting down here, know a lot of y'all have asked for, we've been praying for her. She wants to say thanks for all the cards that y'all sent. She has got them, and she's been very grateful. And just to say another thing, with my mom, she's been waiting for this day for 5.5 years. Both of us in here at the same place. And she's up here. She can't stop smiling this morning. So anyway, I want to introduce to you my older brother. Still love you, still older, always will be. Not wiser. Anyway, my older brother and his wife, Mark and Jennifer Gregg, one of their four children are here today. Toby is down here. And I felt bad when he walked in because he actually dressed and looked a little bit better than I did. I know, don't say a word, Terry, that's not hard to do. Terry's looking at me just like he wants to make the comment. But they are with the North American Mission Board. If you hear them say it, we're used to saying NAM, North American Mission Board. So if you hear that, that's what it means. In Winston-Salem, they work with the Karenni population, and they are currently working with some Afghan population, refugees. And the reason I wanted them to come in today is I wanted you to see missionary and mission work doesn't happen overseas. It does. But it doesn't just happen there. It doesn't happen on the other side of the country. It doesn't happen in poverty and other places. It happens 50 minutes down the road. And as they start to come on up here, this is my brother and my sister-in-law, brothers and sisters in Christ, Mark and Jennifer Gregg. And just pray for them as they're going this morning. Good to have y'all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you hear me okay? Great. Well, my brother threw down the smack. I wasn't going to do any today, but he started it. So I know Jesus said, turn the other cheek. But there might be a comment or two for you coming up here, bro. It is good to be brothers in Christ, though, in addition to being blood brothers. I will say that. So thank you for allowing us to be here this morning. As Robert said, I'm Mark. This is my wife, Jennifer. And you can see from the picture, as Rob already said, we have four children, and our youngest, Toby, is here with us today. It's always fun to serve together. And as you can see from the slide, our ministry is called Together on Mission, and we did that on purpose. We are together on mission. And many times, as you'll hear as we talk today, that it's our kids that have gotten us into some of the things that we're into. So we are with the North American Mission Board, NAM, formerly known as, I guess more than 20 years ago, as the Home Mission Board. And we're serving and working with refugees that have been and are still, this very day, relocating to, in our case, to Winston-Salem, but all over the United States. This is playing out all over the United States. And we credit our oldest two children, actually, for getting us involved in this ministry. They are now 22 and 20 and in college, out of college even. But we credit them for getting us involved in this ministry, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. And we are now still serving Our youngest two children are still serving right alongside of us, like Toby joining us here this morning. I do just want to mention real quick, for those of us watching online, to want to welcome you and wanted to say that we are showing some slides in the church, and we're not showing those online on purpose. There are security reasons, not for Jennifer and me, thankfully, but for our friends, for our refugees. Even though they've relocated to the United States, it's hard to believe there are still security concerns. So out of respect for them, we wanted to not show that on the online program. But we pray that you're still encouraged nonetheless.
Before you change, can you hear me okay? Before you change that, I know I'm going to go off script and he's going to be like, oh no. I want to just take a second to look at our lovely family and just to let you guys know that our story sounds really awesome and exciting, but we are two broken people with broken family, and we're not standing up here saying we have done anything amazing. We're just serving the Lord, and we're grateful for the ways that He has redeemed our lives from brokenness. And we're not going to tell you all our sordid stories or whatever up here, but I want you to know that from the beginning, God works on brokenness. That's how He works. Nobody in the Bible and no one who works with the Lord serves Him in strength and in pride. So we want to just say that real quick. Now we can go back on script.
Okay. Let me pray for us,
and then we'll
move ahead. Oh, great God, uncreated one, King of glory. We thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, that you're near to us now and always. We thank you that you give us life and breath and everything. We thank you for this opportunity, and we just pray now, Lord, Jennifer and I both, that you would get us out of the way, and that it would be your Holy Spirit, Lord, that's speaking today, and your message that is spoken here. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
All right. So, yes, as Rob mentioned, a lot of times when we think about missionaries, we think about international missionaries. And, of course, that is critical and very important. You can see Lottie Boone there. And this is Adoniram Judson, who was the first American missionary who left our shores, first Baptist American missionary, left our shores and went, of all places, to Burma, also called Myanmar. Just going to be a neat twist of the story when we get to the end. He was the first missionary who left, and then these are actually some of the people we work with. Credit him as their spiritual father over 400 years. It's pretty amazing. So, and that is wonderful. And of course, we pray that many people will be called overseas, but some of us can't go overseas for different reasons. And that's what we love about also these North American mission needs. So here's Annie Armstrong, and I found out in doing some of my research that she actually was acquainted with Lottie Moon. They were in the same time back in the 1850s. And so when she heard that Lottie Moon had been in China for 11 years and never had gotten home because there was no one to take her place, she got busy. She was a zealous woman and an organized woman. And she started organizing the women to the women's, now the WMU, Women on Mission. And she started writing letters. She wrote, 17,000 letters. I can't really imagine. Her hand was deformed from then on. She never had the use of her hand all the way. And we think, we don't offer God sacrifices that cost us nothing. Her diligence cost her something. But it's amazing that she knew that women could band together and work to support missionaries all over. And so we love that.
So 5 years ago, we were commissioned at our home church, Calvary Baptist Church in Winston-Salem. We were commissioned with the North American Mission Board. So you say, wow, what were you guys doing before that? Well, we were, as Jennifer mentioned, we're just a typical family. I was an engineer for 25 plus years. Jennifer was a teacher before she stayed at home with our children and started homeschooling them and probably working, not probably, but working harder at home than I was in my engineering job, I'm sure. But God was working on us over a period of time, 8 years, maybe longer than that, to change our course. And I ended up retiring early from my engineering job. And now this is what we do together on mission as a family. And this is what we do all the time. According to the NAM, the North American Mission Board website, there are actually 26 NAM missionaries just in North Carolina alone, which is very cool. And in the United States, way more than that. I couldn't count that high. So it was, I can't give you that number, but in North Carolina, there's 26 alone, serving in widely various roles. It's really neat. Not just working with refugees, but in Winston-Salem, we know a couple that's been doing this a lot longer than us with NAM. And they are serving the inner city of Winston-Salem. They actually picked up, moved into the inner city, rent an apartment, live among the people that they're serving, and that's a pretty awesome thing. There's other NAM missionaries that serve as chaplains, whether in the corporate world, military, public safety, church planting, college ministry, and so many more. You can go to the website and see just all the various ways that our NAM missionaries are serving. And this little brochure that you guys have available here have some neat stories. And I would encourage you to go through the prayer. I know you guys will. The 8 days of prayer, I believe it is, and pray for those missionaries in particular, because the prayers are amazing. They're greatly needed. So for us, what changed our course? What is our story? Well, in 2009, the Karenni people, which we had never heard about before, came from Myanmar, also known as Burma, which we had really, before at that time, didn't know much about. They started coming to Winston-Salem and to our church. And we heard a little bit about that, but what happened was, I mentioned earlier, our oldest two children were the ones that I credit for getting us involved in this ministry. And at that time, they were, I don't know, six, seven, 8 years old. And they came home from church, from Calvary, and said, "Mom, Dad, there are these new kids in our class. They're from another country. They don't speak any English, and we need to help them learn how to speak English, and we need to help them with American things." And Jennifer said, and then I said, "Okay, sure. Well, our oldest child, I'm sure you guys, there's people in here that can relate to this. Our oldest child is very persistent, and he kept asking Jennifer. So Jennifer called the local missionary that was doing then, at that time, what we're doing now, Tim and Jody Cross, were our NAM missionaries at that time. They've since moved on to South Carolina and are working with refugees there. And Jennifer called Jody Cross and said, "Jody, we want to get involved. What can we do?" And so Jody said, "Well, based on where you're at in life with your kids and everything," and at that time, I think we had three kids, she said, "Just go over to the apartments." They were primarily living at that time. They were pretty new to the area, in just two apartment communities in Winston-Salem with playgrounds. She said, "Just go over to the apartments, go out on the playground. They'll see you and they'll come out." And Jennifer's like, really? Is that all we do? And she said, "That's all you do." And so we'll get back to that in just a few minutes.
Okay, so I am working with my son, and he does some public speaking. Both of my kids are doing some of that. And you are not supposed to use your PowerPoint as a note to read. So please forgive me, but I can't see our little notes up there, and I'm going to have to read this. I don't have this memorized. But we use the word refugee a lot, and refugees have been in the news lately, and you hear lots of different things. And when we say refugee, that we work with refugees, we're working with people who have come legally here by invitation, and they come to the U.S. and also to other U.N. member nations. And there's a certain number who we offer to come each year. Sadly, with COVID, we didn't have any, but we are having refugees coming again. And so who is a refugee? These are not just people who would like a different life. Most of them are grieved to leave their homeland, just as you would be. Even if they're in hard situations, they're not really necessarily looking for a different life. But what happens is a refugee is someone who has been forced to flee his or her country because of persecution, war, or violence. A refugee has a well-founded fear of persecution for reasons of race, religion, nationality, political opinion, or membership in a particular social group. Most likely, they cannot return home or are afraid to do so. War and ethnic, tribal, and religious violence are leading causes of refugees in their countries. And that is from the United Nations High Commission on Refugees. So I want to just say really briefly, the reason our Karenni friends, we call them friends, they're not a project for us to work people we work with. We have a great respect for people who have come through so much. But the reason they came is because in Burma, the country where they came from, the majority people group, the military actually came and seized control of their country. And even though they had freedom ever since World War II, because they helped the Allies, they said, "Never, no, this is one country. We want to make us all one people, one language, one religion." So one people, the Burman people, one language, Burmese, and one religion, Buddhism. And so these outlying people were not like that, and so that's why they have been forcibly, and they really tried to wipe them off the map, which is really terrible, and it's still going on today. Our friends lived in refugee camps for 20 years before the UN said this is not going to get better, and so they're not going to be able to go back home. Of course they wanted to go back home, so that's why they get resettled to a third country. And now, when we started doing more speaking in 2019, there were 67 million refugees around the world, if you can imagine. But now I just looked up new numbers and it's up to 89 million. When you see these conflicts in Syria and in Ukraine and in Burma, Myanmar, these people are forced to flee where they live. And it's really a terrible situation. Please remember to pray when you see the news. You know, we can get hardened with all this bad news, but think about, these are real people who are in these situations. How would we feel as far as situation?
So we always want to take it back to the Bible. Does the Bible have anything to say about refugees? Does the Bible have anything to say about this? And as a matter of fact, it does quite a bit to say. Actually, we see in the Bible that God's heart is for the foreigner. And we see several words in the Bible, depending on your translation, to describe refugees or foreigner. We see stranger or sojourner or alien. Nowadays, Jennifer and I use the word international a lot. You hear of international ministry. So we were at a refugee conference back in 2018. And we didn't really have a Bible reference of our own that we were using in our speaking, but this was the Bible passage that was being used at that conference. And it really spoke to us, and we like to incorporate it into our presentation. We made it these two verses, memory verses, in our daily walk with the Lord. And it says in Leviticus 19, 33 and 34, when a stranger sojourns with you in your land, first of all, you shall not do him wrong. Second of all, you shall treat the stranger who sojourns with you as the native among you. And here comes the second part of the great commandment, and you shall love him as yourself. For you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God.
So how do we get involved? So I'm a mom, and I've got three kids at that time. They were around 8 and 7 and maybe 3. Yeah, right. I'm not good at math. So. And so when my oldest son kept pestering me to death about doing this, I just didn't think it was a good fit for him. I didn't know he was going to love to do this. But I finally gave in, and we went to the apartments, and we just fell in love. We would show up at this as one of the apartments. We would go to the playground. The first time we pulled up, it was just the Lord, because we didn't really know much about it. But one of the girls recognized us from church and went and got the other kids and took them out to the playground. And then the moms would venture out. And at that time, no one spoke English. So it was a really good experience for our kids to try to learn how to play games when they couldn't be explained the rules. And it was really neat for our kids to experience some of what they were feeling in everything. Can you imagine going to a school when you can't understand anyone and all those things? And so it was great for our kids, and that was a lot of fun. So when we went and we were going to play somewhere, we just went there. We made our lives intentional, and just was God's working in our hearts and lives. And then after we would go and play and have fun, we wanted to be more involved. Like, how could we help? Because when you're out there and you see needs, you want to meet them. I mean, like if I'm at home in my house and just watching the bad news, I can like turn it off and ignore it. But when you go out there, there's people everywhere who are hurting. If you just look around, and I know you guys do. I know you look around and see the hurting people. But we started setting up apartments, and that was something I could do with kids. Then we moved to picking up the refugees at the airport, and that was really fun. And that little tiny person right there is actually not even Toby. That person is our third child, Levi, who now helps us driving, picking up refugees from the airport. He gets the midnight shift. If we have to pick up refugees really late, I have to stay home and take care of the others and He and Mark will go out at midnight and pick up refugees sometimes. And he helps carry all the stuff that they bring.
And it seems so, like they always come in at midnight.
Well, the planes, if they're late and all that as well. So, and then it just became really a special time for us when Toby was born. That's Toby there with one of his aunties. They loved Toby. It was really a time for them to give back to us and to watch, to really be a part of our lives. And Toby would go with any of them, and they'd spoil him to death, like you can imagine. And we would go into their homes, and we would learn different ways. We would eat in their homes, and in their homes, we would sit on the floor. They would bring out a lovely mat. They would fold it out and then bring the food, and we loved the food. God was good to us to help us to learn to love food like that. Some of our kids, maybe not so much, and they say, I just want plain rice, and that's fine too. It's just a blessing.
Well, for Toby, what is it, bud? It's sticky rice, right? To this very day, Toby loves sticky rice, and wrapped in the bamboo leaves. It's his favorite green food, right?
With sugar.
With sugar, that's right. So out of that, it was just natural for us. Our friends had invited us into their homes and shared their culture and their food, and they shared their stories. And I'm going to try to keep it together. It's always hard, but the stories are tough sometimes. They've lost loved ones. They've lost everything. They come with nothing. And like Jennifer mentioned, for 20 years, some of them lived in refugee camps. They weren't free in these camps. They weren't free at all. And there are so many now that even still live like that. So we invited them out of that, out of them having us to their homes. We invited them to our homes, the whole families sometimes, and then sometimes just kids to play with our kids. And they would just share their stories with us. We would share our American culture and our food with them. And also, of course, with what we do, when the opportunity presents itself, we're always thinking about sharing the gospel with them. Many of these families that came, the reason they came is because they're Christian. So a lot of these families, they were persecuted because they were Christian in a Buddhist country. But we still have families that we work with, quite a few, and we get the chance to share the gospel with them just by living life with them. Sometimes it's uncomfortable, like Jennifer, I think, said a little bit before. There was a language barrier at first. So it was good for our children to experience this, right? It's uncomfortable. You're put in uncomfortable situations. You don't know what you're saying, but a smile just goes so far. And this people, the Karenni people, they're quick to smile, they're quick to laugh at themselves, and it taught us to learn how to not take things so seriously and laugh at ourselves. And it was good for our children, and good for us. But I want you to see the statistic on here, if you can read it. If not, I'll read it for you. But we want to change this. This is one of the reasons why we go and speak, that around 75% of internationals living in the United States never see the inside of an American home. And we just want to encourage to change that everywhere we speak. Let's bring that number way down. This could be refugees. It could be students that are here on internationals that are here on student visa or just here on international work visas. And it could be other internationals. Let's invite them into our homes. Let's share our lives with them and teach them some of the things that they would like to know about American culture. They want to fit in. And then we can listen and ask their stories as well.
That's right. And a lot of times when we ask their stories, they ask our stories. And interestingly, we have this thing in America, a lot of us feel like, oh, we can't talk about religion. But we haven't found that with internationals. We work with a lot of internationals who talk about religion just as a natural part of life, because it is a natural part of life. And we're not trying to forcibly convert people when we work with them. We're trying to see when they think of Christians and they think of Jesus, they have a friendly face who's working with them, that's what they think of instead of stereotypes. So as our kids grew, their friends grew as well, and we started having Bible studies with the refugee teens, and we would have fun activities, and we would have Bible study, because the Bible is the most important thing, you know, besides actual salvation. Learning the Bible, how to study the Bible, depending on the Bible for everything is the most important thing we can share with refugees. And so we love doing that. We still have some good relationships with these kids today. We're growing up, getting married, having kids. It's amazing. And then I think I mentioned these are not, this is not a project for us. We don't say, oh, these poor refugees, you know, these people have come through a lot. Those who came with faith had a much stronger faith than they had, because faith was all that they had. And so we have been blessed to be able to work with them and empower them to reach their own people, to serve themselves, to serve each other. And so when we found, we asked them, like, what is something that you need? After they've been here a while, this probably was, I don't know what year this was, but this was after a few years. They said, we need more pastors in our language. We had the first Perini ordained in the U.S. pastor at our church. And he was, and still does, go all around the country doing pastoring things, like marrying and burying and baptizing. And one is not enough for the whole, you know, nation, as you can imagine. So more pastors, more leaders, more women's leaders, and people who can minister to women, and youth leaders who can minister to youth. So we empower them for that. And our refugee VBS, you guys are sure doing VBS, Vacation Bible School. And in the beginning, we did a special one for the refugee children, before they spoke English, so we had one just separate for them. And then a few years later, they had become teenagers, and they wanted to do one for their own people. So in this case, they did the speaking, they did the snack preparation, they were the teachers, they did the music, and we just kind of facilitated that. And that's one of my favorite things about all of this, is empowering them. And letting them serve and even to go back places where we can't go. They've been able to go back to Burma and Myanmar and serve there where they can blend in and we could not.
That's right. Well, that is one of the goals, is to help our friends to be self-sufficient, to for dignity's sake. They want to provide for their families. They want to, I don't know if blend in is the right word, but they want to fit into America. In their new homeland. And so we'd love to help them to do that. So new opportunities. So after the shutdown during COVID, and my brother Rob mentioned this a few minutes ago, we also work with folks from Afghanistan. And so this new opportunity, as I'm sure everybody saw on the news about a year and a half ago, presented itself, where a new group of refugees started coming to the United States from Afghanistan. And so we had the chance to start working now for about a year and a half with people from Afghanistan as well. Just a side note, there are quite a few other refugee people groups in Winston-Salem that we don't necessarily work with. Other people work with from the Congo and from other places.
Well, because people groups have their own things, kind of like the from the north, people from the south, you know, here in America, different country right. people, city people, I mean, all kinds of things. So it's hard to help all refugees because they're very different.
Right.
And actually, the Afghan people we've been working with are very different from our Karenni people. God has helped us to be kind of insightful. And since we already didn't think of refugees as lesser people, it was easy for us to quickly figure out these people that we work with are very intelligent, very, very... wonderful people that have a lot of skills and strengths to add to us personally as well as to our country.
That's right. So one of the differences with our Afghan friends as they came, with our Karenni friends, it was more likely than not that they didn't speak English. With our Afghan friends, usually at least the dad comes speaking English. So that, as you can imagine, that's a huge help to them. They can find work quicker and just move through the process, get their driver's license and all that, and do a lot of their own paperwork, which helps us a bit, quite a bit when they can do that. Because the paperwork, oh my, it's quite complicated. But we're with our Afghan friends, we do a lot of the same similar things that we did with our Karenni friends. We help with transportation needs, help find housing, airport pickups, and medical appointments, all of these sorts of things that we've done before. And here's some pictures of us serving with our Afghan friends. You can see Jennifer with a car full. I think that was a moving day on a very cold day. They were moving from one house to another. Housing has been a challenge, so you can pray for us in that, for our friends, as we try to help them find good housing, good safe housing. Jennifer's reading a book to a little boy there, an Afghan boy. Jennifer and Toby are playing there with an Afghan, the Afghan children. And then you see that feast there, and it's amazing. We've had several meals that we've shared with our Afghan friends over the last year and a half, and it's always a feast like this. The food is amazing, and it's a lot of fun. But living life together in this way is just so awesome. And it takes time to build the relationships. And by doing this, we help our friends through their trauma and their desperate situations and circumstances that they came from. They need to process that, and they love telling their story. And it helps to turn that into positive, and we do it all in the name of Jesus. That's the beautiful thing. And you can see on the slide here, we have been told countless times by our Afghan friends that we are like family. So our Kareni friends, a lot of them came, and they came together as families, big families, and were able to be reunited together. As you recall with what happened in Afghanistan, it was just chaos. And they've gotten separated from their families, and they're all over the world, literally.
So, yes, and a lot of their families are left behind. Yes. Only the people who work with the Westerners were able to leave. And so their mothers, fathers, brothers, and sisters are left behind, and they're worried about them because it's a dangerous place. All right. So one thing that I really love about NAM, the North American Mission Board, now, they really hone in on five areas of focus for their send relief. And so, like, we've landed on the second one there, care for refugees, but they've got programs and plans to help churches strengthen communities, which formerly maybe was poverty, care for refugees, protect children and families. This is adoption and foster care primarily, fight human trafficking, and then respond to crisis. I'm sure you guys are pretty aware of the disaster recovery ministry that a lot of people here in North Carolina are a part of and have been for a long time. Those are areas where we try to go and meet needs in Jesus' name. And like Mark was saying, we do all of these things so that people will, we have a chance sometimes to speak the truth of Jesus to their lives. And they've got this really cool thing called ministry centers. And we just put some of them on there. If you'll go to the website, www.nam.net, there's all of these places. They've got mission centers, ministry centers that focus on these areas, like the ones we talked about, these five areas, and you're going to say in a minute. You can go and take a trip, just you and your family, you and a small group, and go do these things. And even if you have a ministry close to your heart that you're working on here, they can help you support you as you start a ministry. So the church is God's plan to reach the nations. So sometimes we've had to go outside of the church to do a lot of these things, but I think they're really realizing we need to be able to do it as a church, because when you go and you plant churches or you work through the church, people, our lives are changed, and then we go out in Jesus' name and can help others.
So has anybody in here heard of Clarkston, Georgia? Familiar with it? Ever been there? Okay, no problem. In 2019, we went on a vision trip to Clarkston, Georgia, Jennifer and I and our third child, Levi. And Clarkston is a suburb of Atlanta. And they have resettled refugees there in Clarkston, not only from Burma and Afghanistan, but seemingly from everywhere in the world. It is known as, you can look it up, this is really cool, it is known as the most diverse square mile in all of America, with over 60 countries represented and over 100 languages in one square mile. It's simply astounding. There's a church there that NAM is very much a part of called the Clarkston International Bible Church. We had the opportunity to go there, not for Sunday morning, but just to go see. And I know you can't read that sign there. That is the sign for the church. But on that sign, in addition to the fact that they meet as a congregation as a whole, they have churches that break out and they meet and worship in their own language, which is a really cool thing. But there's Nepali, Congolese, Karen, the Karen people, which is also from Burma, Bhutanese, Pakistani, and Sudanese. This was back in 2009, or 2019. There might be even more now. So we went on this trip to get some vision that we can bring back with us to Winston-Salem and get some ideas. They also have a business center there, which is really cool. This is up and running now. It was a vision when we were there, but it's up and running now. Again, one of the goals is to help refugees be self-sufficient, to have that dignity, to provide for themselves.
Oh, and I haven't said it yet. Sorry, this isn't the best slide, but I haven't said it yet. I may as well say it. Okay. So when refugees come, and at invitation of our government, they're given 3 months rent. And can you imagine? So in 3 months, they're supposed to be self-sufficient. So by that time, though, they've got jobs, they're working, they're learning English, and it's amazing that they can do that. And of course, we work with them much longer than 3 months. That's not enough time to be self-sufficient. But that's what time the government says, that they'll support them and give them these resources. And then in about 6 months, they start repaying their travel loan. So we flew them over here, so they start paying that back. So this isn't like a bunch of people who are just mooching off of our economy. They're coming and they're becoming participants in our economy, and really a blessing.
Right. So they have that business center to help them, for those that want to be entrepreneurs, start up a business, and then they get things going, and then they move on from there to another location. And by the way, many of our Karini friends actually work at Tyson Foods in North Wilkesboro, which is
a huge amount.
Right, not too far from here, a huge amount.
Yeah.
What, 100? Maybe more?
I don't know. A whole lot. Because it's a great job if you don't speak English, and it might not be something.
And if you do speak English, too.
Well, if you do speak English as well, I'm sure.
Yes.
But you know what I mean. If you're trying to provide for your family and you need insurance and you need all those things, you need to go somewhere where it's not essential.
They've been very good to
our
people, yes.
Yes.
And some other processing places around the North Carolina.
That's right.
So as we move towards closing, we always want to take it back to God's Word. And Psalm 119:105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." So before I get to these two verses here, we always want to keep the Great Commandment at the forefront of our Christian thinking, always. Our worldview, our biblical worldview. Matthew 22, we all know this, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus told us who our neighbor is. He made that clear. And in Matthew 28, gives us the Great Commission to go and make disciples of all nations. And I would put parentheses on that to say, God is bringing the nations here, right to our communities, to our backyards. So go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that Jesus has commanded us. So there's that discipling part. And the goal is to make disciples. It can make disciples and multiply and have church multiplication. And Luke 19:10 says, "For the Son of Man, Jesus, came to seek and save the lost." And in Psalm 67:1-3, "May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise, O God. Let all the peoples praise you." Amen. So, as a country, we have certainly, I think we can all agree, been blessed. We are certainly blessed in this country. And God has blessed us to be a blessing.
So, what would a Sunday morning be without an encouragement of some kind of application? We can pray. Even if you can't go, you can pray. We can pray. And prayer sustains everything. So I love that you guys have this to pray for these. And you guys already support missionaries. I know you pray for them. It's really vital. Give. Give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. Give to the missionaries you support. Go. I mean, there's some chances to go overseas, go around our country, or go next door, which sometimes is harder. Go. And then live. Live for Jesus. Out of our brokenness, not because of who we are, but because of who Christ is. We can do all of these things because he's the one who gives us our strength. Thank you, God, so much.
Yes, thank you for allowing us to be here today and to speak. I think my brother's going to share a little bit more about this later, but we do have a prayer card, and we would love it if you could take our prayer card. He's going to leave them laying around, and if you could put it on your you remember us in the presentation, if you just would think to pray for us and our friends from Burma, our Karini friends from Burma, and our Afghan friends also, and especially our Afghan friends right now, but all of them. It's a hard time for them as they're trying to get on their feet and get going again when they were used to that before. So I am going to close us in prayer, and I think my brother's going to start making his way back up here, and I thank you again for this opportunity to share. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for everything that you've done for us. You are so good to us, Lord. You are faithful. When we are not faithful, Lord, you're always faithful. We thank you for that. Father God, we pray that you would give us a heart for the nations and just a heart for the great commandment, Lord, and for the great commission. Let us always be about doing your business, Lord, in everything that we do. You again, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank them very much for being here. They're stories that they cannot tell you. That's going on with their Afghan refugee friends right now, including being threatened still. And that's why a lot of the pictures you saw, their heads were cut off or they were at a very far distance. Their things are going on. This is going on in our backyard. This is happening here. We've got a population, not of Karenis or Afghans here, but we definitely have a population in this county to where we could even focus on. You got Hispanics, you got the Hmong, and you got many others here in this county that we could reach out to that are coming here. But I want to say on that next to last slide that you had, I was going to say this anyway, but I'm kind of glad you said it too. Every single one of us is called, listen to it, to be a disciple that makes disciples. We take and we replicate the process. We don't bring people in and make converts. We bring people in to make disciples, and we send them out into the world to make more disciples. That's what the early church in Acts did, and that's what we do. We are to, everybody in here can take part of missions. Everybody is called to be a disciple maker. How can you do that? Every single one of us is called to pray. Every single one of us is called to give to missions. Most of us are called to do missions, either in our community or take small, short trips to different places in our country or even overseas. Some, very few, but some are called to go on mission trips for a month or 2 months. We're going to have Todd Payne here in a few weeks. He goes to India. He's going to tell you about his two-month trip over in India, which is right up against Burma. He's a local missionary. I need to put y'all in touch with him. Anyway, we'll get back to that. And very, very, very few people are called to give up everything they do and spend their lives pouring out their lives for others. But we're all called in some way to do mission work. Francis Chan, I've got the book right up here from David Platt, but in the foreword, Francis Chan, in this book called Follow Me, he says this, what if, each and every day. What if we change our mindset? What if each and every single day we view as a mission trip wherever God has placed us? Amen and amen. And that's the way it should be. We've got a mission field in your homes. We've got a mission field out there. We've got a mission field all around the world. Let's spend every day pretending and thinking and having the mindset, I'm living in the mission field. God's got me in the mission field. What do you want me to do today, God? So, as I begin to close up these cards that we'll have on here, we're not taking up a love offering for them. But what we're going to do, what we have, is on these cards that you can pray for. There is also a link if you wanted to support my brother and sister-in-law. You can do so. You can get on the North American Mission Board site to find it. There are instructions on that. If you want to give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offer, you see what it's going to right here in this area. And so my invitation today, as Chris gets ready to, we get ready to sing for an invitation. My invitation is very simple. I'm calling every single one of you again, just like I did last week. I'm asking you today to be praying, obviously, for them. I'm asking you to be praying for this prayer list that we started. We did the prayer week this past week, ending today on day 8. Ask you to be praying for these that are in here. I've got to say this. Fall, is it? This fall. They're going to be highlighted in part of the daily bread that we have passed out here.
Open windows.
Sorry, not daily bread, open windows. But they're going to be in that, this for the fall edition. So they're actually going to be in there for this. But I ask you to be praying for them. I ask you to be praying for the North American missionaries. I ask you to be praying for our missionaries on our list. And I ask you to be praying for the IMB, the International Mission Boards, and those missionaries too that we took up with Lottie Moon. But I ask you today to be coming up here to pray for them. And not just for them. I ask you to pray for yourself too. Where God has you. What is the mission field that you have today that you need to be doing? Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. That's not a call for me and the deacons. That's a call for every single one of us. Let's go be on mission each and every day. So I'm going to ask you to go ahead and start standing. These cards will be in the back up here, in the back here in the fellowship hall. The prayer today is very simple. If you want to come pray with them, come pray with them. You need to be here at the altar. And let me ask you this. You cannot close without bringing the gospel invitation. Maybe today, even those of you online, maybe today you feel like a refugee, an outcast, someone that doesn't belong. There's nothing and nowhere that Jesus Christ will not reach. And if you feel like an outsider, we got deacons, you know, I'm up here too. Come talk to us, and we'll be glad to share the gospel with you and talk to you about it. But come and pray for our missionaries all around the world. Maybe we're not going, but we can do something about it. We can pray, and we can give. So, brother, what are we singing today?
57, Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace. So will you come this morning and let us just pray over them. Let us pray over our missionaries. Stay too long because we are Baptists and we're going to go eat together, so don't keep us too long, please. But if you want to come by and say something, we'll get the cards out and we'll have them here. But just thank y'all for being here. I want to say before we close up in prayer, I love you and you know I'm here for you. Didn't ask them, but I'm going to put them on the spot. Brother Allen, would you mind closing for us today in prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this privilege. We pray, O Lord, for all missionaries throughout the world, throughout the United States.
Love y'all. Have a great week.